Yes, it's working. Good.
Okay. Some of you might have heard about it before in the last course, Fundamentals of Bioinformatics. We started discussing, for example, the most widely used program, maybe even worldwide, but certainly in the life sciences, and then, of course, the program BLAST. And BLAST is performing something called homology searching. With a given sequence you would like to learn about, we call the query sequence, and then you try and mine information in databases, and in this case, sequence databases, in which typically millions of sequences are deposited. And if of those sequences something is known, you use the homology principle and transfer the information from a related, putatively related sequence onto the query sequence. Okay, so, but first I would like to say this is about the master. Our master, most of you are in this master program, so we have something that is called the education committee, where students and lecturers meet, and there is a chair to discuss issues about the master. So we need students, so this is a call to you. And so students who do it, they say, well, this is really a good thing to do, because you sit at the other side of the table, you think about programs and checking what works, what does not work, and so on. And of course, we need your view from the student perspective in the committee. So there are one of or two vacancies in the OLC, that's the Dutch name for it. So if you feel incensed enough now to come and let it know when you think about sitting in this board, to send a mail to Anton. He is the chair of this committee. Okay, so basically, your master probably needs you, okay? And this is what we see happening all the time, yeah? Both combinations. Okay, but now on to homology searching and sequence databases. Now, you might know this already, but sequence databases in generally tend to grow exponentially. And here you see some proof of that fact when you just record the numbers over years. I've shown you, I think, this slide also. This is when you logarithmize the axes. A straight line then points at exponential growth, and you see that databases generally do this. I already told you, of course, that for sequence databases it's even more dramatic. That's exponential growth, but with a doubling time of less than 6 months. And that is much faster than computer power grows on this planet. So that's quite serious. So that leads us to worry a little bit about a gap that exists between sequence databases, where the data is growing like crazy, and other databases, for example, structural functional databases. Finding out what a protein sequence or what a protein is doing is a lot more work than sequencing nowadays. So these databases tend to accumulate data less rapidly, at a smaller pace than sequence databases. So that means we have abundant sequence data, less so, relatively speaking, for structural and functional data, and so we need to fill that gap, and of course homology searching is one of the key tools, key principles to do that. So, definition, you have a query sequence you would like to find out about. You have letters, you have a sequence, and you'd like to compare that's the idea, to very, very many sequences typically deposited in a database. And the goal, of course, is find a sequence, one or more sequences, that are related to your query sequence. And what kind of relationship, of course, is a fundamental thing. And here we try to establish an idea about an homologous relationship, so an evolutionary relationship, because that has implications for functional transfer. What do we want about a tool? We want it to be fast. That's the primary thing. You don't like to wait for two or more days. You'd like it instantaneously. So one realization is, if you think about it, there is a database, the standard sequence database that serves as an input to the BLAST program, has roughly 6 million sequences. And if you search with query sequence, of course, it is immediately clear that the vast majority of those sequences will be unrelated to the query sequence. There might be maybe 5,000 family members if it's an abundant genome. You know, some Some genes, of course, are more represented in databases than others because people like to work on them all, like kinase sequences that are important for cancer. You know, the sequence databases are riddled with it. And other sequences might even be orphan sequences when there is very little information available. So it's an uneven world. But in any case, the vast majority of the sequences deposited in a database will be unrelated to the query. And a quick way of, you know, doing a quick step is, you know, getting rid of sequences that are obviously, hopefully, unrelated to the query. But this is a risky step because we know how to establish a relationship and a 30% in sequence identity. We have reason to believe it's homologous, but there is no such thing like if it's lower than 5%, it clearly is not homologous because there are so many examples where there still is a relationship at that sort of similarity level. And that means that you know, you can only talk about it's too low to establish homology, but that's different from saying it's non-homologous, there is no relationship. So it's a bit risky. You might throw away too many sequences in a step, but at least you get rid of it and you can speed up doing this. So the idea is roughly a two-step rocket. First you get rid of many sequences, and then those sequences that are left over, you scrutinize a bit more and really try and establish, is there an evolutionary relationship? So that's the fine-tuning here. Okay, so just, you know, why bother? There are some methods. This is a historical method. I'll try and cover today, otherwise it will happen on Monday. And the Monday lecture, by the way, will be done by Anton. It's one lecture on second step on homology modeling. Because I'll be in Paris and can't be here. So I try and cover it, but at least we do BLAST. And, you know, from the last couple of lectures, or the first two lectures in this course, you learned that the scale, how algorithm scales, the speed of the algorithm is the product of the sequence length. So it's n squared when both input sequences to a pairwise sequence analysis program would have the same length. And in generally, two unequal sequences, two sequences with unequal sequence length, it will be m times n. And that is really too slow for this type of approach. Database sequence searching. Here you get just an example. Say you have, you know, an average query sequence of, I don't know why we get to this number, but 300 something amino acids. A while ago, release 38 contained some 30,000 letters. So if you concatenate all the sequences, that's the size of your database. And that means if you would compare a query sequence to this database, you would already have 10 billion steps. Yeah, and if you want to run such a program, like on the NCBI server near Washington in America, a million times a day, you know, you need a big, big, big supercomputer and it won't work. So this is too slow. We need to speed up. And, you know, one realization is if you want to compare one given query sequence against 5 million sequences, you do 5 million steps that are maybe totally independent. You don't need to combine the information. You know, you collect the numbers, the scores in the end, but doing the work. So that is what computer scientists refer to as trivial parallelization. You know, I give you a simple-minded example. Maybe I did this already, but you know, some people say, okay, if it takes 9 months for a woman to get a child, there might be a product manager might come in and say, let's speed this up. We take 9 women and then it takes 1 month. And obviously that doesn't work like this because this is an inherent sequential project, you might say. But many projects might work like this, that you can just segment the steps that need to be taken and do those in parallel at the same time. And then, of course, it's important how interdependent are these sub-projects. So if that is not happening, like in this approach, you can easily do it. And that is referred to as trivial parallelization. So today, talk about these methods, and I hope to, as I said, to capture also FastN. This is for historical reasons, but another thing is there is something that happens in FastN, is a technique called hashing that I would like you to know about. So that's the main reason of talking about it. Okay, so BLAST stands for Basic Local Alignment Search Tool. This is a heuristic tool, and heuristic is a sort of a rule of thumb. So it means the answer by BLAST is not a super duper always valid answer. It's a good approximation of what might be happening. So no guarantees. You probably get good hits and they might be related, but there might be other hits. It's speed is the main driver of BLAST, and under the requirement of bringing, you know, upping the speed, they try and retain as much as possible about the sensitivity. So here again, you know, basic ideas: get rid of unrelated sequences first, fast, and then, you know, worry about the remaining sequences, to what extent might they really be related. Okay, and you work with sort of, you know, with these pathways. We've seen those in alignment. So basically, you in BLAST, you're basically going to worry about these diagonals that represent segments of similarity in a sequence. Now, BLAST works like many approaches in computer science and in programming with the concept of k-words. That means just a subsequence of a defined length, so a word of length k. And BLAST uses words in general that have length 3. So 3 words, or 3mers, they're also referred to. So k is a parameter representing the length of any word, and, you know, for proteins it's, I already said, 3, here 2 to 4, and for DNA you typically take words that are a little bit longer, and that, you know, is related to, of course, the alphabet size. There are only 4 nucleotides and 20 amino acids, so the combinations of the number of possible words grows rapidly. A 3 word, how many possibilities are there? With 20 amino acids, the answer is 8,000, 20 to the power 3. And for a sequence of 10 long on the DNA level, how much is that? 4 to the power 10, 2 to the power 20, what is it? Maybe close. Let's say 1,000,000 and a bit, right? So, a bit more than that, but that's what you get. With 10.
So okay. Why 3 and...
That one is longer than the other, as I said, relates to the alphabet side. Why exactly 3?
Yeah.
Because the other, so you retain, the longer the words, the less hits you find, and the shorter, you know, so it's a good balance between speed and sensitivity, basically, that's the answer. But we'll go into how it works, and then you can feel if that, you know, if you agree with the 3 or not. Okay? So, basically, these words are just... And basically, computers, if you look for a word, a computer is able to really find exact matches to words pretty rapidly. But if you compare to sequences that have undergone evolution, and we would like to say, hey, we want to see an evolutionary relationship between sequences that only have maybe 3 out of the 10 letters equal with exact sequence matches, you know, you won't hit a lot, right? And that's a bit of a problem. So that's why the BLAST people started thinking. And they said, you know what, given the concept that really this is what you prepare, you know, a 3 word in the query sequence that is RKP, you know, I would only find RKP in the database sequence. But, you know, if a biologist would tell me, yeah, but RRP is also quite related to RKP, you would like to find that as well. How do you do this? And that's sort of an easy trick that BLAST happens. By the way, scoring this is quite easy. We attach a number. You look up these scores in the BLOSSOM matrix discussed in the last lecture. You add the values you find, and that is the score for your 3 word. Okay? Okay, so basically, this is how you score and how you find basically the similarities in the first step in BLAST between a query sequence and a database sequence. Now, the BLAST steps are... we use that fact to basically pre-massage the query sequence, index this a little bit so that we can then later on use that representation of the query sequence to quickly scan each database sequence. That's the idea. So you prepare, and that preparation you only need to do once for the query sequence. So if it takes half an hour, okay, it's half an hour wait, but it scales just like that block of work, right? It's not the length of the sequences do hardly matter for this. Then you use that to scan the database sequences using this concept of k-mers, and the BLAST people have made nice words for everything, and they call this T similar matches, and T is a threshold, but I'll get to that, yeah? And then an extra step is, when you find the initial diagonals, you say, can I make these a bit longer, make them, so to say, a bit more biological? These are the steps that BLAST takes, and we go into them. Now, okay, so, first what you do with BLAST is you chop up any query sequence into so-called 3 words. I said that the k-mer is like 3, so here you see what happens very easily. The first 3, the second 3, the third 3, and so on and so forth. And these are all the words that you have in your query sequence. Now, for each of those words, you're going to ask, like, you know, if in the database I find also an LVN as a word, that's good, but maybe I would like to also find other words that are related, but not identical to that, eh? Evolutionary considerations. So you want to find similar words rather than identical words, so similar and also non-identical words. Basically, what you do is, for each of those three words, you build a table of other three words that you consider close enough. So that is how you do it. So, for example, for RKP, it might be that you say, well, if it's QKP or KKP or whatever these words, I consider those similar enough to this word. So if I would look in the database sequence using this word in the query sequence, I would accept those as similar words to RKP. So basically, for each of those words, we're going to build a little list of words that you would accept if you encounter those in the sequence, in the sequence database. So basically, the slide, let me have a quick look, because the slide seems to fall here, they're there, but this one slide has fallen out. I'll put it in later on, and I'll put it on the blackboard. So how to do this very easily then. If you do this on the blackboard, the slide comes in later. So basically what you're going to do is, I already asked you the question, how many possible three words are there? And you said 8,000, that was very good. And so you have three words, so let's say RKP again. I build a little list. Here are the 8,000 possible words, A, AAC, and so on and so forth. And the last word should be, what's the last letter in this alphabet? Y, I think so. There you go. Here I've got 8,000 words. Now I build and I compare them. I compare this word with each and every one of the 8,000, and I score them using the Blossom matrix. So this word might be, I don't know, look up R, A, K, A, and K, P, add them up. You will have some score here, right? So you have a whole list of scores. And now you have the T, the letter was already mentioned. You take a threshold value, and I think in BLAS it's either 9 or 11, that varies, something like that. So then you say, if the score is higher than that threshold value, say 9 for now, then I accept that word as being similar enough to RKP so that I hit it when the database says, that's similar to this one. And probably in this list of words that are okay, the word RKP will of course come up as a high enough scoring word because you have the RRKKPP. And you know the diagonal values in an exchange matrix were the highest, right? So that will make it probably. But it could be that if you set the T very high, that it might be that some words will not have any related to it, and others might have them. Yeah, it's possible, depending on your... But the setting 9 allows, of course, each of the words to have a number of good enough words, if you like. Yeah? All right. So, that's how this works.
And we do that for every...
You absolutely, very clever point, I should have said. For every word you make this little list. For every query sequence word, right? And this is what you call pre-processing the query sequence, establishing that lists. And now we have to put this stuff in a framework that allows us to calculate quickly. Because, you know, we said we want speed, and now we make it complicated. And for every word you have to go through the loop. So this sounds slow, right? Not good enough.
But
yeah.
The list is a hash table.
Sorry?
Is a hash table.
Yeah, I get to that. It will be hashed. Yeah. I'll show you how BLAS does it. So basically, there is a piece of technology to do this. So as I said, each word, there is a little list is being made. And now there is automata theory in computer science. And these things are called DFA, standing for deterministic finite state automaton. I'll give you an example about some words. Don't worry. This is just a trick to really make sure you can use these fragments, these gamers, and still search quickly. So what is a DFA? A bit of theory on that in general. Basically, and pay attention, later on we'll talk about hidden Markov models, network models, and they will look, you know, very much like this. It's not the same thing, but, you know, the way of thinking is it. So basically, what have you got? You have a state you can be in, and you have transitions between states, and, you know, your network is of course defined by the nodes you have and the transitions, and that, you know, defines how you can progress from one state to the next, right? And now you do, in a DFA, you do a special thing. This is the traditional form. You say, you know, this state I would like, wherever you start, if you may start anywhere, I will be happy when you get in here. And then I stop and I say, congratulate, let's eat cake. Then you have 1 point. This is a hit. And we would like, of course, to establish this success if we find a word that is in that similarity list. Yeah? Then we say, we're happy. We find a hit word. So basically, this is what it happens. This is the classical finite state automata theory. And basically, what we will do is, for each word, we will put all of these words that are possible for each free word in a machine like this. And make it such that, you know, we will quickly, and computers can use this very, very quickly, to use it. So if you have a query word of, what is it, I don't know, RRP or something, in the, so basically, it can quickly find those words as neighbors, as related words, to that query sequence.
Sorry, okay? Can you give an example?
Yeah, I will do that in a moment. It comes. I'll give you an example. So one little deviation we'll do. Classical DFAs have this accept or reject or accept on the state. If you're in this state, you say, I'm happy, I accept it. If not, you're not yet accepting. But there is also the Mealy paradigm, and that is what BLAST uses. And that is, in fact, you say, I don't want to be in a given state to become happy. I would like to I look at the transition. I will be happy when my sequence goes through this transition. It's sort of the same thing, which you don't accept on a state, but on a transition. So now we go to the BLAST example. I have to apologize because it will be big. So I do it for just two words, not for three words, but that doesn't matter. So we have a query sequence. Here's your example, and we want to build a DFA that recognizes the words for that query sequence QL, QM, and ZL. With real BLAST, it will be ZQL something and so on, right? It's too long instead of three. But here you go. This is a Mealy machine, and the red transitions are those that lead to accept of the situation. Now, have a look. Do you see that this automata indeed will be happy when it encounters QL, QM, and ZL? I will not be happy when it encounters any other word. Shall we start? So here, you know, you start in this by definition, right? That's enforced. This is your start state. So what will be the first word, the first letter you might encounter? Either a Q when you talk about the word QL or QM, or a Z when you would talk about the word ZL in this case, right? So there you go. If you encounter Q, what happens? You go through this transition. Come in this one, and what would you like to see as the second letter? If you've seen a Q, I guess you agree with me that should be the letter L or M. So if that happens, you're here, and you say, I'm happy. I found a word that is in the list for my query sequence. Right? You don't think that difficult. This one, it should not be difficult. So what's your problem?
The recursion of Q there.
This one?
The ring of the...
So you start. So these are the three words you should accept.
Yeah. But
so you see, you go here, you see a Q.
Yes.
You go here. Now, if you see an L or an M, you talk about this or that word, you say, I go here, I'm happy, I stop. I've seen the word.
If I see a Q, I stay in the other state.
Yeah. Because then it could be QQL, yeah. Then, you know, then it's Q. Yeah, so you give it another chance. And if you see the Z, then you go here, and of course, then the only way of becoming happy is seeing an L after that. Yeah. And again, that same thing if it's Z. You can do the stop.
So when do we stop?
Sorry?
When do we stop?
When you stop? Well, when you, in this case, you stop, good point in general, but you would stop when you, so you stop, of course, here, but you would also stop when you go through here and then say, not found now, right? Not found.
So whenever you stop there. Through a red transition, you stop?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Back. So,
you start again. Yeah?
If one of the two words would be QQ, then you would just draw a Q. After Q, red.
Yeah, then you would have a Q here as well.
Just draw the top red
one. So you would have a Q here in the red thing, but then you ask if you need this one then. Do you need that one?
One of the two mirrors is QQ.
Yeah,
okay.
Oh, if you encounter it.
No, I think
yeah, you stop. You would stop here then, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, okay, so is this. That's a bit of a confusion, perhaps. Is this an automata where that you slide over the whole sequence, or do you say you use it per word?
Per word.
Yeah, that's a big difference.
So,
yeah.
So stop. When we found another
what's the idea?
Acid that is not in the model.
Yeah.
We get out of this.
You go through here. And then you say you start again.
But this one we can slide now.
You can slide. This is the idea. You could slide this one. Yeah. Okay. So that's and of course this happens for three. And these machines are built for each query word. So in all, this is a bigger thing than you see here, of course, for blast, right? But it allows computers. This is one way for to use the capabilities of computers to quickly search for identity equal or unequal and still allow flexibility. Right. That's the idea. Okay. So. This is what happens. So BLAST will, and how does it work? So let's talk you into the direction of seeing how you build up this matrix with diagonals. So let's say, I don't know, the BLAST folks put the query sequence here, I think. And the, I'll do it now in the BLAST way. Oh, then this should be the query sequence. And this should be a database sequence, okay? These guys are mathematicians. So now the diagonals will look like this. An alignment we're just used to make the path, the BLAST people do it like this. Can everyone see it? Now I do this. Sorry. Yeah? This is the drawing I was talking about before. So what happens? You find a three word. Because you have this mealy machine that is somewhere there, you quickly, if you encounter a word in the database sequence, you immediately see, that's in the query sequence. So you put the three thing in, and maybe you will have a few like that. You go through the database sequence, immediately you have it. So it means you do not need to go build up a quadratic, you go linearly through a sequence, and immediately you have all of those. Yeah? What happens if you have the word QLP that hits, QLP, and then LPR that hits? What happens if you do this? Then you had a word of three, but now this word is also matching, and you know, diagonals can grow when you do this. Right? What happens if the two sequences would be equal? You would build a nice diagonal, right? And it would go. That's probably a related sequence, hopefully. Okay? So, that's the point. Diagonals, so you are able to quickly build a matrix with diagonals like that. Okay? Using indexing. Okay, so basically, how do we use this to now build and get a good picture of is this query sequence related to the database sequence? So there are two programs that do this. Now the list is there. Now I see it. Okay. We have Classical BLAST 1919. The people came and they said, "This is great. We are great guys, and we have made a great program." It's a very heavily cited paper, the BLAST 1919 paper, one of the most cited in the whole of science. I think it's close to 60,000 citations, and that is really astronomical. If you have 100 citations, you know, ooh, that's a paper you're proud of, right? So, this is crazy. Tell you a little story, one of my friends. Des Higgins, multiple sequence alignment, comes later on. Also, that can be widely cited. He had a paper in 1994 that did well. In 2014, all kinds of high professionals, including the boss of the university, the rector, stormed into his office and said, "What did you do to us? You made us drop 55 places down the world ranking as a university. You're a terrible man." And then he said, "First, explain to me what happened." And then he said, "No, you should not, you know, do like this. You should congratulate me what I've done before." What happens? He had a paper, like the BLAST paper, that he cited also 47,000 times. And the university, you know, this is used in the world rankings. What's the only little problem? Papers have a 20-year window. So the counts drop. So if you have a highly cited paper, the whole university suffered when that paper was taken off the list and the university went back down, you know. So that's where you put your cards on a single entity. It's always dangerous, like if you have a risk assessment. So that's what happened. So they told him, "You write another paper, that's okay. Wait a year. It will be done." Anyway, so that's about citation. So the program is used a lot. So in fact, now you get easily the slides that I talked about. This is the list that you build. But so you have these diagonals built up. And now what do the BLAST people do? This is old BLAST in 1990. This happens, but in another way now. But this still happens. Here you go. How is the reasoning? You might have the initial hit. This is just on this wheelie machine, and this is the initial diagonal you have in this matrix, right? It might be 4-long, 5-long, maybe 3-long. And then you say, okay, you know what? I'm going to try to extend this diagonal. This is just the beginning, and I would like to go in this direction, see what happens, and go in the other direction, see what. Maybe I can make it a bit longer to get a better idea of what segment is basically related, localized. So, what do you do? And this is the simple thing. This is a simple heuristic again, or a simple stop criterion, if you like. Because what do? If you would go up, and what, you know, you look at the score of it. You have the blossom score again. So, what happens if you would get a negative score? Well, that's not so good then, you know, takes score away. But maybe later on it might pick up again, and you get positive scores and make up for it. So this is what you might see here. You know, this is maybe you start here, you go to the right, the step, you go down, but you say, hold on a moment, I'm still hoping for the best. And then, yeah, good, it picks up, goes up, then it goes down, and you have a simple criterion. You say, you know what, if it falls off more than this epsilon, then I say, sorry, I stop. Simple. Is this good? No, because it might have been this goes, it's just here, it goes down, and then goes up like, I don't know, you would miss it, right? Bad luck. Yeah. That's what you have with a heuristic. It makes it, but you've set these parameters that it will be reasonable. But this is the simple thing. So what might happen, and then, of course, when you drop off, when you stop here, you say, oh, this is too bad. What do you do? Do you stop here? No. You use your intelligence. You say, what's the best extension that's here? That's the high score. So you go back to the last top of the hill. Yeah.
So basically store like inflection points, like points where the slope of the curve starts to decrease.
Yeah, now where the slope goes up, so you climb this until you would stop according to this criterion, you drop off too much, this epsilon, and then you go back to the last point, which hopefully is the highest. It might be, could it be that this one is? Well, depending on how you set the epsilon, this might happen. So you go back to the highest top, wherever it is here, you would say. That is safe, right? So that means that this drawing, you go all the way till here, you're here. You should use this, otherwise I'm standing in the way. So but then I need two pointers, sorry. So you go back, and this might be, this top might be here. So that means the final extension, if you do this, is the yellow bit, right? This is just this dirty green bit. This is this bit that you would not take into account when you go back to the highest hill. Yeah? Simple criterion used like this by the blast people. So you see all kinds of tricks and heuristics, a little bit dirty, but you know, it works and we're happy enough. And it's a good program in the end. Now, then, so this is what blast did. And you know what? How do you extend? I'll go back to this picture to give you a feel. Yeah, this one. So here are the blossom sums, so you might extend here. So basically, let's say your epsilon is 4 or something, right? What would you do? In this case, you would say, oh, I extend one, oh, this is good, one extra point. But here, oh, I fall off 2, oh, that's still okay, I can maybe pick some, but then I fall off 3 and say, oh, that's too bad. It's more than 4, so I've dropped off too much, you go back to here. And the same might then happen here, when you go like this, it's still okay. Maybe depending on your threshold, your epsilon, this might be too bad, you would go back to me. What kind of alignment is this between the query scene? How many gaps do you see?
Zero.
Good number, 0. No gaps. And if you extend, how many gaps do you get? So these alignments in BLAST, what are they? They're gapless. How good is that if you want to have distant sequences related? Do we expect gaps? I've been talking to you all the time, gaps, important. Well, what was the problem about gaps, do you remember? There is no mathematical system to just, you know, we cannot have an exchange matrix for gaps. It's guesswork. It's, you know, oof, we look for the, you ask biologists, when do you get nice alignment? Yeah, with a gap penalty of 10 and 1. Okay then, we use it. That's how it works. Ask the expert. The BLAST people, they were also not only good scientists, but they were certainly good marketeers. They said, you know, what is the great thing about BLAST? It generates, hold on a moment, I'll finish and then I'll come to you. So you don't get a tired hand. What was I on? What track was I? Yeah, okay. So all these alignments are ungapped, and the BLAST people said, you know, one of the great things about BLAST is that it generates ungapped alignments. And that's great, because we don't know how to score these anyway. So, of course, it's much better to have them not in the first place. What do you think? That was good reasoning, right? That's fantastic. That's sales. That's good. Anyway, so in fact, it was not a great program, but they yelled so hard about it that people started believing this. The program FAST A, I'll try to cover at the end, but I don't tell you too many stories. You know, it was early and was in fact better because that would allow for gapped alignments. The BLAST not so effective. BLAST A was a better program, but these guys were the shouters and they won initially. In 97, bit of history, we got the other flavor of BLAST, and then they could make gapped alignments, and then they were really better. But it took in fact 7 years where BLAST was not as good as FAST A, but it was already used.
So classical BLAST stops at this?
Yeah, because he's still waiting. So, go ahead.
About the difference between the blue and the red.
Okay, let's say your threshold is the epsilon is 2, including 2. So you go to extent, 1 point extra, that's fine, right? Oh, you fall off 2. That's just borderline, so we go on. So hopefully it picks on again this positive score. It doesn't. So we stop here. And you say, okay, what's then the best? The extension until here, because that's positive. Now we go in this direction. My example is not good. It should be -3, including -3 as the threshold, because here you say, maybe this example is not even good. I would have put a more -4 here and then another letter. And then it's clear. So basically, you go, so here it's clear, right? If your threshold would be 2, including 2, you go here, but then you would stop here. And you go back to this point. And the same happens here, depending on your threshold.
Doesn't this favor very good alignments, since then the drop-off is sharper than when you have an alignment with a lower score? If the cutoff,
yeah, this cutoff, yeah,
needs to fall,
yeah,
if that's an absolute number, then if you have a good alignment, then the difference,
yeah,
between a
red, yeah, 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 you could take a percentage, you could do all kinds of things, they keep it simple. So I didn't make BLAST. I'm not defending it. I'm telling how it is, right?
Well, it seems kind of.
That leads me to another small story, which I shouldn't tell because I promised you FAST A. But anyway, this program is so popular that criticizing it is very dangerous. I tried it once and never did it again. They didn't kill me. I'm still here, but it was close. And I had to flee to the toilet almost and so on. What are you to say bad things about our BLAST? You know, that's you get sort of religious reactions. It all adds to the significance of BLAST. So that's how this extension works in the old BLAST version, yeah? Then in 97, as I said, here is the paper, very well-cited paper also. They came to look at the great names, you know, two-hit method. And then you get BLAST, you know, so they're now they're proud of gapped alignments. Further said, you know, we don't make gapped alignments because it's bad business. And then he said, look, the great thing now is we have gapped alignments. Okay, people let it all pass. Basically, one thing was with the old alignments that, you know, all this extension business, even if it was a cheap heuristic, took, you know, 90% or more of the compute time. And they said, well, that's maybe a bit maybe still slow. Can we do better? When should we extend? Because you try and extend every diagonal. So it's a lot of work. In the end, you select a few. So what can we do? Can we make this a bit, can we become a bit more selective? Extend better and still save time. Something like that. So that was the idea. And so what they started saying, and that sort of, they said, okay, you know what? We think a bit more on the alignment and we do another extension. I get to that in the picture that will tell you more than these lines. Basically, also they said, given, you know, this T parameter, do you remember where that was? That was, you know, for selecting your list for each three word, right? What happens if you set your T lower? Your list becomes longer. What does that mean biologically?
More hits.
That you can capture more distant sequences, right? Because if this, you know, you say, okay, if you put it very high, then, you know, you will have near identical sequences. So, if you want to be biologically more sensitive, you would like to lower the T, but in the old situation when you do this, you get so many diagonals, and then it gets crazy with all of the extensions, so they couldn't do it. So this is how it sort of works.
Here you see on the diagonal, you see the blast focus on mathematicians, they do it like that. So this is now the diagonal. You see here two hits, and the idea is if these two hits are on the same diagonal in the matrix, and near enough, the distance between them is less than 40, I think is the current setting, then you say, hey, they're sort of related, and now I will look at this as one thing. Now I say, this sequence scores high enough, this is an important point for me, and all of this other stuff is too bad. Well, if you have a single one that scores very highly, you take it as well. If you have, of course, how many diagonals do you get when you have two identical sequences? Well, at least one main diagonal that will be very prominent. You could still have a few here and there, but you should take that. But basically, you look at two hits at the same diagonal. If they're close enough, if the spacing is 40 or less, you say, I'll go on with this sequence, this is a good guy, this sequence might be related, and now I'm going to find out how is it really related. What is the real alignment between the two, the real local alignment. So basically, in words, what happens, you trigger another alignment, and we've now got really, the next step will be really alignment. We'll trigger it, but what we need a starting point, a single starting point. We have two points here, two segments if you like, we want to make one starting point of that, and we do this by finding in this region of so basically, you can think about it for yourself. So you are on sort of a diagonal. Here you have a segment, and here you have a segment. It's close enough. Yeah, and basically you want to make one point. Well, how they do it? They take a window with a central cell, slide it over, add up the scores, the blossom scores, and find, you know, that piece in the sequence that has the highest score in this region. And they start, maybe it's here, maybe it's here, we don't know, but one point in that matrix. Okay, you select again using some heuristic like that window. You call that the seed, by the way. Yeah, so you have the seed. And then, we'll go to the next slide. It's a classical slide from the last paper. Here you go. This looks, I don't know, pretty gross. But here is your seed at one point, and what do? This is dynamic programming. But you see two funny things. You're used to have calculated pathway using the whole matrix. Is that a question or?
No.
You had a question. Well, ask it now then. Now I stopped.
You said if the two hits are on the same diagonal. But I can't imagine how they couldn't be on the same diagonal.
Since
that would be that is a gap if the
diagonal is different. Well, that's good you say that. If it's on the same diagonal, what is there a gap or not? How many amino acids in the one sequence do you jump and in the other? If it's on the same diagonal?
Same!
So this would lead to an alignment without gap still, right? If you would do it like that. So basically, the information you for selecting to scrutinize and build your seed is still based behind the screen a little bit on a gapless alignment, if you like. Are you with me? Let me do it in the break. Yeah? But then you have the seed, and this is dynamic. You go, basically, you calculate all the pathways in one direction. So this is the normal direction as you know it, yeah, going down two sequences, and this is the other direction. You do dynamic programming, but you do it against the sequence direction. How could you do this? Reprogram your script, let the indices run down instead of up, for I equals 1 to whatever. Now you go from L back to 1, but there is a much easier way to do that. If you are asked, you reverse the sequences, right? Hey, I don't know what the blast guys do, but anyway. But now you see it's not the whole matrix they try and calculate here from that point on. It's part. What do? They have a termination criterion, a stop criterion, and you've seen this one before. So they do the same thing. They say, okay, if I go on and the direct product says it goes down, if it's, you know, picking up again soon enough, I go on, nonetheless. And that makes that, you know, this sort of funny shaped matrix is the result of cutting off your calculations based on this criterion. Okay? Heuristic. Because it still needs to be done for quite a number of sequences, and you don't want to spend all of that time. So this is the other heuristic, and you stop. And this is dynamic programming.
And what do you get if you make dynamic programming? You can go to the right and to down and diagonal. What is that? Gaps. So this will lead to gap alignments. Okay. So the two-hit method is just a way of selecting more vigorously, because all of these other diagonals will be gone. You don't look at them anymore. And if there is no two hits on the diagonal, sorry sequence, you're out. You're unrelated in our book. Is that really true? Could it be? Of course, you will have sequences that are biologically still related. You won't find. So biologically, you pay a price, but the computer is happy because it only needs to calculate less. Okay. So this is what you do. So basically, this is all there is about BLAST. And then it starts reporting well. It's doing some statistics. There will be the next lecture to find, you know, how good is this score really. How usable, and some of you have run BLAST, you know what numbers you look at, right? An E value and so on. That comes in the next lecture. Basically, what they could do is, because this selection is more rigid, you do less extension, they could lower the T parameter. And the end result was, the T was this, how long the list is for each of the three words, remember? They could lower it, take more into account, more diversity into account, and still they were faster, whereas they did. This is never happening normally, right? You make it more sensitive and it becomes 10 times slower. This was and more sensitive and faster. So that was a good innovation. Yeah, they could rightfully be proud. In 97 it was okay when they were proud, because also they published SideBlast, which is a great product. So basically that is what happens now. So they do two-way local dynamic programming using that stop criteria that I just talked to you about. Okay, let's do... Let's do coffee, and you can ask your question.
This is for any database case.
Dus ik zou zeggen, ze laten het verbeteren. Dat zit onwijs, dat ga je ook toelaten als er wel een beter spacing is.
Elke keer bedankt voor mijn vraag gekomen. Ik denk dat je met mij dan een punt dat dat gaat bij technologie niet. Want hoezo is, als ik hier sta, hier, dat ze niet op dezelfde manier gaan. Ja, oké, dan is het alleen als zo dan heb je een definitie van gaps. Ja, dat is
Yeah. introduction.
Even naar boven gaan.
Yeah. with this one. The last one. Okay, which
so everyone is
for the
lecture. But it's in winter jacket.
Certainly.
Check it out. I did put up all the slides of last year, but some people tell me can't find it. Something is happening, let's see. Edit, move to share to comments. Okay, I'll sort it out during the practical, okay? This should be published somewhere. There is a click button. Yeah? Yeah.
If it's helpful to you, I have this.
I should have switched. I should do this. Sorry.